Москва.
जी नमस्ते।
नमस्ते।
हाँ प्रणाम प्रणाम
प्रणाम।
हेलो प्रणाम
प्रणाम। और माननीय श्री वत्स जी को भी मेरा प्रणाम। आशा जी को नमस्ते।
नमस्ते। नमस्कार।
नमस्ते। राधे राधे। जय कृष्ण।
जय श्री दर्शन हुए। बहुत धन्यवाद।
बहुत दिनों के बाद आपको सुनने का मौका मिलेगा।
अरे
तो याद है
काशी होना पड़ेगा।
नमस्कार।
पहले ज्वाइन करेंगे तो बात। सबको नमस्ते। सबको
समझ क्या मतलब शुरू
यार, इसमें आवाज नहीं आ रही। अनुष्का यार, ये अपने आप क्या क्या हो रहा है।
क्या हो रहा है पता है।
राज साहब आजकल दिल्ली हैं या पटना है, कहाँ हैं आप?
हाँ जी, अभी जी अभी मैं पटना में हूँ। कोरोना काल में ज्यादातर पटना ही।
हाँ, सब ऑनलाइन ही ऑफिस चल रहा होगा जहाँ तक है।
हाँ ऑनलाइन, यहाँ दो आदमी हैं मेरे साथ।
जी जी, जी।
उनका प्रोफेसर रामकृष्ण राव जी के समय ये प्रावधान बना था
जी,
जहाँ भी चेयरमैन रहेंगे ICPR के वहाँ वो ऑफिस कंडक्ट कर सकते। लेकिन महीने में अभी भी 7 दिन तक हम रहते हैं वहाँ, कोरोना के बावजूद भी। 15 अगस्त में वहाँ थे उस समय।
अच्छा।
और फिर अभी अभी जाने वाले हैं 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, सब वही रहेगा। तो करीब एक हफ्ता जरूर रहेंगे वहाँ।
जी जी।
आप सब वृंदावन में ही अपने आश्रम में हैं।
वृंदावन धाम को छोड़ के कहाँ जाएंगे?
नहीं, आपका बायोडाटा तो देख रहे थे, बहुत रिच बायोडाटा है, हिंदुस्तान के बाहर के सब यूनिवर्सिटी में आपका लेक्चर होता रहता है।
वो अब भूतकाल की बात हो गई।
हाँ, लास्ट लेक्चर हमको लगता है कि जब राव साहब थे
जी,
तो आपका हमने सुना था दिल्ली में।
उसके बाद हम और आप लोग बिहार में साथ थे, आपको कुछ ध्यान आ रहा हो तो, रामानुज जयंती थी।
जी जी जी, भट्ट साहब भी आए थे उसमें।
भट्ट साहब आए थे, आप पधारे थे, और साउथ से कई लोग आए थे।
जी,
आपकी कृपा मुझे मिलती रही है लगातार।
हम तो आपको बनारस हिंदू यूनिवर्सिटी के दिनों से जानते रहे हैं।
देखिए, पूरा युग हो गया।
हाँ, दिलीप जी को नमस्ते।
हाँ, नमस्कार, नमस्ते,
नमस्ते।
हेलो
जी,
हेलो,
आशा दीदी नमस्कार।
नमस्कार, नमस्कार, नमस्कार।
आशा दीदी मेरा नमस्कार सुन रहे हैं कि मुजरिम हाजिर है?
नमस्कार,
मुजरिम हाजिर है,
मुजरिम हाजिर है,
आपकी बहुत कृपा है।
नहीं, नहीं।
आपकी बहुत कृपा है। नमस्कार साहब, नमस्कार पंडित जी।
ओके, आर यू एम ए विजिबल?
यस, आई कैन सी, आई कैन सी प्रोफेसर पंडित।
ओके,
इट्स अ प्लेजर।
थैंक यू, थैंक यू।
नमस्कार आशा जी, आई हैव आल्सो जॉइंड यू।
नमस्ते,
नमस्ते सर, हाउ आर यू?
क्वाइट फाइन।
ओ, नमस्कार प्रोफेसर। Actually, I'm having some problem with my laptop, so I was trying. Somehow the voice is not working. I don't know why, with Google I'm having problems. So anyway, I joined with my mobile. I can't see everybody, but whatever little I can see. I think Dilip Mohanta has also joined.
Yes, namaskar.
Hello.
Dilip Mohanta is very
good. I joined.
Yeah, good, good. It's a pleasure to see everybody.
Good to see everybody, yes. Good.
Yeah, Alice is there. Jain Saab is there. KL Sharma Saab there. And Professor Pandit, Pankaj Ji, Dilip Mohanta, and Professor Singh. And a lot of people are there. What a pleasure to see. Ajay Ji. And we have a lot of students also joining. Saji from Nehu, from Shillong is there. And I can see many people. My friend Anand Singhal is there. Nilima Ji is there. Wow, wonderful. Abhinay, Anubhav is there. Some of my students have also joined. So it's such a pleasure to see everybody. Yeah, great, great. शर्मा साहब कहाँ है? Can I see शर्मा जी?
जी जी जी, प्लीज।
प्रोफेसर केएल शर्मा,
नमस्कार। प्रोफेसर आरपी सिंह जी, प्रोफेसर आरपी सिंह।
यस सर,
नमस्कार,
कैसे हैं आप? सीइंग आफ्टर अ लॉन्ग टाइम। या हाउ आर यू?
Fine. Now the virtual world has become the new normal.
Yes, yes.
The new normal.
The pandemic has become academic.
Yeah, the world is totally different now.
Yeah, new normal.
Manish ji, has Yogesh ji joined? Manish ji? Hello? I can't hear you, Manish ji.
मैं अभी उनको डायल करता हूँ, दिन में कोशिश की थी बात नहीं हो पाई थी, वापस कॉल करता हूँ मैं उन्हें एक बार।
चोपड़ा साहब फोन किए थे, क्या बात है? व्हाट डू यू मीन? हाँ अभी शुरू हो गया मीटिंग। ओके बताएंगे कल।
सर प्रणाम।
योगेश मैम से बात हूँ, बस वो ज्वाइन कर ही रही हैं, कुछ नेटवर्क
इशू है। कहाँ एक आए कि चले गए?
हेलो हेलो, आवाज आ रही है?
हाँ जी, आपकी आवाज आ रही
है। अच्छा, तो आपके अगर परमिशन हो तो हम शुरू करें प्रोग्राम।
जी आरंभ करें।
जी ओ रश्मि जी भी आ गई। नमस्कार रश्मि जी, नमस्कार,
कैसी हैं?
नाइस टू सी, मैं ठीक हूँ बिल्कुल। केएल शर्मा साहब कहाँ हैं, दिखाई नहीं दे रहे? अच्छा, तो हम शुरू करें फिर आज का प्रोग्राम।
तो हम शुरू करें फिर आज का प्रोग्राम।
प्रणाम, मैं मणि बोल रही हूँ सर। सर प्रणाम,
हेलो हेलो,
हाँ शुरू कराओ आशा।
थोड़ा आवाज कुछ प्रॉब्लम हो रही है सर।
नहीं प्रॉब्लम नहीं है, बिल्कुल क्लियर आ रही है।
आप ठीक कर रहे हैं? अच्छा ठीक है,
बिल्कुल ठीक आ रही
है। आशा दीदी आपकी आवाज आ रही है।
अच्छा ठीक है। May I request everybody to please mute your microphones. Only those people who will be speaking will be switching on the microphone, please. Please make sure that your microphones are off. Hello?
So microphones have to be turned off.
Yes, please.
Okay. Yes, please. By clicking on it, na?
Right. Just click on the microphone. Mute it. Yeah. So let us start the program. I'm sorry for a little late because I had some problem with the connecting, I suppose because of the Google. Anyway, namaskar and good evening to everybody. Respected distinguished speaker Acharya Goswami ji, Shivats Goswami ji, Professor R.C. Sinha ji, Chairman ICPR, Professor K.L. Sharma, President Daya Krishna Academic Foundation, Professor Yogesh Gupta, Vice President Daya Krishna Academic Foundation, Professor G.L. Pandit, Professor Jain, Professor Rashmi Patni, Nilima ji, and many other friends. It's such a great pleasure to see everybody here on this platform. And also the members of Daya Krishna, like members of Daya Krishna Academy Foundation, dear friends and students. I'm delighted to welcome you to the 9th Daya Krishna Memorial Lecture by Acharya Sri Shivatsaji Swamiji, a noted spiritual leader and professor, philosopher of the country, and a very close associate of Dayaji on Bhakti Samvad. He comes from the family of eminent scholars of Sri Radharaman Mandir of Vrindavan and a leading figure in Vaishnav tradition. He is the director of the Vrindavan Prakalpa, a multidisciplinary research project, Indira Gandhi National Center of Arts, New Delhi, and he has published 8 volumes on Vraj culture and history. He has widely traveled universities India and around the world, including Harvard, Heidelberg, and his book Celebrating Krishna, which was published in 2003 by Motilal Banarsidas, is received with much acclaim. He represented Hinduism at a historic meeting of world religions in London, was a resource person in Vienna, and plenary speaker at centenary celebrations of American Academy of Religions. Pope invited him to the Vatican in 2012 as one of the main speakers at the Interreligious Harmony Week. He is one of the honorary presidents of the World Body Religions for Peace. The President of India gave the Lifetime Award of the Sangeet Natak Academy for overall scholarship and service to Indian lecture, and we are delighted to have him amongst us. His long association with Dayaji is surely a reason to compel him to accept our invitation in spite of his very busy schedule and engagements with various activities. We are also grateful to Professor R.C. Sinha for readily agreeing to preside today's lecture. He has always been very kind to the foundation and has been a part of our activities over the years. This lecture was originally scheduled for 20th March 2020, but at the last moment, due to COVID-19, we had to postpone, and now we are having it online. शिवत्स गोस्वामी जी, आपने कहा मुजरिम हाजिर है,
एकदम हाजिर है।
आज की अदालत में, आज की अदालत में आप मुजरिम नहीं है, आप ही जज है।
मैंने जज तो सिन्हा साहब हैं और आप लोग सब हैं, पूरी ज्यूरी बैठी हुई है।
So we are especially delighted to see many friends, Rashmi ji, Nilima ji, Jain saab, Dilip Mohanta, Professor Pandit. We are seeing him after such a long time, and many other friends who have joined. I can't really see everybody, but I'm really delighted to have each one of you. A word about the foundation. Daya Krishna Academic Foundation was established in 2011. With 7 founder members from different parts of the country, and since then we have been organizing Daya Krishna Memorial Lecture annually. Professor Miral Miri, Professor Dean Chatterjee, Professor Richard Sorabji, and Professor Purushottam Billy Moria, Professor Arindam Chakravarti, Professor Janardhan Ganeri, Professor Garfield, Jay Garfield have delivered these lectures consecutively. We plan to publish them in the form of a book. We have also been organizing national seminars since 2008 in Jaipur, Lucknow, Jammu, twice at Bombay University, Vishwabharati, Shanti Niketan, and next is due by the end of 2021. We are delighted to inform that a special volume on Daya Krishna of Guwahati University General Philosophy is published last month. More information about the foundation is available on the web page, although the web page is not very regular. We have we are trying to revise it and reform it. So the web page is dayakrishnafoundation.org.in. We have also renewed Daya Krishna essay competition for young scholars, and we will today announce the results of the winners of essay competition of 2018 and 2020. And I also welcome the winners who have joined today online. So may I request the distinguished dignitaries, Professor Sinha and Professor Kiel Sharma, and also Acharya Sri Shivatsa Goswami ji, to please join to release the special volume on Daya Krishna of Guwahati University General of Philosophy. You have already received the copies we have sent. And I will also request Professor Shorab Pran Goswami, if he is online, please to join us to release the volume, who is the chief editor of this journal. Has he joined, Professor Goswami? Shorab Pran Goswami? I think he was telling me that he's traveling, so perhaps he could not join, it seems. It seems he could not join. But we are really grateful to him for extending this gesture, kind gesture, and to the whole editorial team of Guwahati University General of Philosophy for providing this opportunity. So thank you very much. And thank you, Sinha ji. Shivas ji, Acharya ji, aapko mila ye volume? Hello? Hello? हेलो,
मुझे
हेलो आचार्य गोस्वामी जी, शायद कनेक्शन में कुछ प्रॉब्लम हो रही है. एनीवे आई थिंक वी हैव फॉर्मली रिलीज्ड, एंड लेट अस थैंक द टीम, द एडिटोरियल टीम ऑफ गुवाहाटी जनरल यूनिवर्सिटी जनरल फिलोसफी. इट हैज ट्रूली बीन अ प्लेजर टू वर्क विद देम, and we are grateful to the editorial team. Thank you so much. Please also join to facilitate the winner of 2018, the essay competition. The title was The Role of Religion in Life. So the first prize is prize goes to Miss Venda Shisha Mary Nonbri. She's a student of Northeastern Hill University. Are you there, Vanda Shisha?
Yes, ma'am, I'm here.
Yeah,
yes,
can ma'am. can you switch on your video, please?
Yes, ma'am, I have switched on my video.
Wonderful, wonderful. So we are happy to announce that you have won the first prize. Vanda Shisha.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Congratulations. Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. The second prize goes to Nila Patra. He is from Vidyasagar University. He's a scholar. I would request Nila Patra to please switch on the video. Nila Patra, please. Yeah, here. So we can see Nila Patra. Congratulations, Nila. And thank you for joining us. Thank you so much for taking interest. And the third prize goes to Madhubi Prasad. She's studying. Madhubi, are you there?
Yes, I'm here. Yeah. Actually, I'm doing research from Mumbai University.
Mumbai University, good. Yes, good. Right. She's basically from Nagpur, as I can see her address.
But ma'am, that time I was in Nagpur, now I came to Mumbai.
Okay, wonderful, yes, wonderful. So thank you so much.
Ma'am, ek cheez bas bolna chahti hu, like
finish the announcement, all right? I'll come back to you, all right? The next competition, essay competition of 2020, we could not hold the essay competition for 2019 because of the COVID. And we had to postpone that. So in 2020, we revived it. And the topic was, am I free to choose? And the first prize goes to Aditi. She's from Center of Philosophy, Jawaharlal University. Aditi, are you there?
Hello, yes, ma'am.
Hello, yes, ma'am.
Aditi, please switch on your video, please.
Yeah, sorry.
Great, hello, great. Ma'am. Congratulations, Aditi. I'm so happy. Yeah, okay. The second prize goes to Banushri Kumar. She's from Department of Philosophy, Guwahati University, Assam. Banushi, can you join, please? Banushri, are you there?
No, he's not there.
Okay. The third prize goes to Ananya Chaudhary. She's from Department of Philosophy, University of Delhi. Are you there, Ananya? She had confirmed that she'll be joined.
Ananya is there, just before.
Ananya is there. Ananya, can you hear me? Ananya? I think she can't hear. Anyway, so we have these six students, young minds, who have won this essay competition. And I want to congratulate each one of them. And I would request the blessings from all our foundation members and also from the chairperson Professor Sinha Sahab, and also from Acharya Srivats Goswamiji to give them the blessings. And we would request them to show their certificates. We have already sent them to the audience so that everybody can see that they have received the prize. The first three have already received the prize and also the certificate, and the other three will be receiving soon. So we would like them to display if they can, and share one or two words, sentences, if they want to, so that we can hear their voices. Although this is not the place, we actually plan to invite them in one of the seminars, you know, which we'll be having, and we would like to listen to their thoughts more, you know, in a more scholarly way rather than, you know, just a ceremonial way. This is only a ceremony. So I really want to welcome them to have to join our academic activities, which will be at the end of this year, around 2021. We are planning an annual seminar, and let's see how it goes. We'll invite all of them and join, and we would like to listen to them. So maybe we can start with Vanda Shisha, if she wants to share something.
Ma'am, I have already received my certificate, but I don't think it's visible. If it is visible, I have already received it. Thank you so much. And a good evening to everyone present here. It is my honor to be here among the prestigious and eminent people of our country. My name is Nanda Shisha Mary Longpi, and I am currently a research scholar in Northeastern Hills University from Shillong. So regarding the essay that I have written, it was what inspired me. And so I could put my thoughts into writing. I would like to thank God for the inspiration, and a special thank you to Dayakrishna Academic Foundation for organizing this essay competition, which was a way for all of us to display our thoughts, our talents of writing. And I am also thankful to all the judges for seeing the ability in my writing. And this will encourage me in the future to contribute more to the philosophical family. And thank you for felicitating me and all my co-owners who are present here. A big thank you and a special one to Ma'am Asha for always for being there with us, for cooperating with us and for finding us, because the competition was from 2018. So I believe during finding us our contact information, and also it would be difficult for you also. Thank you so much, Shima, for honoring us with this certificate. This means a lot to all of us, and thank you so much. You will do well and better, and will write better for everyone, for contributing towards the country's better future and success. Thank you so much to everyone.
Thank you, Vinda Shisha. Neela Patra. Yes, Neela.
Number.
Very briefly, please. Sir.
First of all, thanks to my all members and teachers and madams and my friends, all us in the webinar. Thank you for my teacher, जिन्हें मैं हार्दिक से नमन करना चाहता हूँ कि मेरे सर ने मुझे इस टॉपिक में काम करने के लिए बहुत सहायता की है, और मैं इस ऑर्गेनाइजेशन को भी मैं नमन करता हूँ कि मुझे इस टॉपिक में काम करने के लिए एक अच्छा टॉपिक मिला जिस पर काम करने का मुझे मौका मिला, और काम करने से मुझे पता चला कि रिलीजियन का मतलब क्या है वास्तविक जीवन में, और उसे हम कैसे अपने वास्तविक जीवन में हम उपयोग करें, और जो रिलीजियन का जो एक बैड कल्चर चल रहा है अभी हाल ही में, हम अगर देखें तो हमारे यहाँ जो इंडिया में नहीं अगर बाहर और बाहर के स्टेट में जो बैड कल्चर चल रहा है रिलीजियन के ऊपर, इसके ऊपर बेसिस में एक अच्छा टॉपिक मिला और लिखने को भी मौका मिला, और एक जगह था मैं उसको मेंशन करना चाहता हूँ कि रिलीजियन के ऊपर जो हमारे जो टेररिज्म का जो एक्टिविटीज चल रहा है उस पर जो लिखाई मिली, और उस पर जो हमको जो एक सेमी और बोलते हैं ना एक सेमी पॉइंट मिला, उस पर वो सेमी पॉइंट मिलने से हमें पता चला कि ये जो रिलीजियन का जो अहमियत है हमारे वास्तविक जीवन में, और रिलीजियन को लेकर जो कल्चर चल रहा है अभी हमारी हाल ही में अगर देखें तो जो पेंडेमिक चल रहा है, ये एक तो पेंडेमिक है और एक पेंडेमिक चल रहा है, हम लोग जानते हैं और देख भी रहे हैं। तो मेरे ख्याल से अगर हम प्रेजेंट टाइम में अगर आए और इस टॉपिक को लेकर अगर हम और डिस्कस करें और इसके अंदर अगर घुसे हम, तो हम देखेंगे तो वास्तविक जीवन में इसका प्रासंगिकता जो हमारे बंगाल में कहते हैं हम जो
थैंक यू नीलम जी, थैंक यू नीलम जी,
प्रासंगिकता प्रेजेंट टाइम एक्टिविटीज इन रिलीजन लाइफ,
वो हम आपको सुनना चाहेंगे नीलम जी,
बात है। तो थैंक यू फॉर ऑल टीचर्स एंड मेंबर्स एंड माय सर जिन्होंने मुझे इस टॉपिक पर काम करने के लिए मौका दिया और मुझे इस लायक बनाया। सो थैंक यू फॉर ऑल,
थैंक यू सो मच। माधवी प्रसाद, वेरी ब्रीफ प्लीज।
यस मैम, थैंक यू वेरी मच मैम, आशा मैम, रिस्पेक्टेड आरसी चेयरमैन रमेश सर, थैंक यू एवरीवन फॉर गिविंग मी दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी हियर। सबसे पहले तो मैम मैं यही बोलना चाहती हूँ कि आप लोग जो ऑर्गेनाइज कर रहे हो, राइट, दया कृष्ण जी जो थे वो संवाद में बहुत बिलीव करते थे, डायलॉग पे बहुत बिलीव करते थे।
आप लोग जो कर रहे हो एक प्रकार का संवाद कर रहे हो, आप एक दूसरे के साथ संवाद कर रहे हो, हम स्टूडेंट के साथ संवाद कर रहे हो, हमें एक प्लेटफॉर्म दे रहे हो कि हम अपनी आर्टिकल्स लिखे, हमारे थॉट्स लिखे, आप तक पहुंचा सके, तो इसके लिए बहुत बहुत थैंक यू, दिल से शुक्रिया कि आप लोग हमें ऐसा प्लेटफॉर्म प्रोवाइड कर रहे हो। जहां तक रिलीजन की बात है, मुझे लगता है कि ये कॉमन बिलीफ है जो हम सबको यूनाइट करके रखता है, एक स्ट्रॉन्ग यूनिटी देता है हमें, एक हेल्दी माइंड सेट देता है, तो मुझे काफी एक इंटेंशन प्रोवाइड करता है हमें कि हम आगे बढ़े लाइफ में, हम अपना एक पर्पस क्रिएट करें लाइफ में और आगे बढ़ते रहे। तो एक रिलीजन में, रिलीजन का तो बहुत महत्व है, यहाँ पे इतने बड़े बड़े गुरु बैठे हैं तो मैं उनके सामने ज्यादा कुछ बोलूंगी नहीं, बट काफी बहुत महत्व है इसका। तो आप लोग ने मुझे ये स्टेज प्रोवाइड किया, इसके लिए बहुत थैंक यू, एंड कोशिश करूंगी कि आगे भी आपके प्रोग्राम में मैं पार्टिसिपेट करती रहूं।
बहुत अच्छा माधवी, आपने बहुत अच्छी अच्छी बातें कही और असलियत में आपने एकदम हम जो करना चाहते हैं उसको एकदम सही जगह पे आपने पकड़ा है, और हम आपसे संवाद बिल्कुल करते रहेंगे, और यही हमारी यही हमारा उद्देश्य है इस का। तो बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद आपको। थर्ड सेकेंड इस कॉम्पिटिशन की विनर है अदिति। अदिति जी है हमारे साथ में जुड़ी हुई शायद?
यस मैम, आई एम हियर।
अदिति, yes please tell us few words, very few.
Yes ma'am, so first of all I would like to thank you for the opportunity, and secondly the article that I wrote came directly from my experiences of freedom. It was on freedom, am I free to choose? So my stand was I am free to choose but with social responsibility. So it was all entwined with Daya Krishna's essays, and I also took help from Kant and Sartre and that's all. Yes ma'am. Thank you
so much, Aditi. So I want to really, I want to thank from our heart on behalf of Daya Krishna Foundation and on behalf of all the people who are present here, to all the winners of this essay competition participants, and also those who have actually participated in the essay competition. I want to thank each and everybody, and also those who have helped us in evaluating the essays, because we have a team of evaluators who have been helping us from different disciplines. So I really want to thank everybody. Now, coming back to the theme of today's memorial lecture, the title is Transgressing the Four Walls, Bhakti Supreme Purushartha, as Supreme Purushartha. Dayaji's dialogue on Bhakti can be considered as one of the most important event of present times. It demonstrates how we can have a dialogue with the various living intellectual traditions in India. I may please be excused for saying that Daya Krishna, who devoted his whole life to philosophical writings, wrote so much on Indian philosophy and questioned almost all the foundations and presuppositions of Indian philosophy, has not been taken as seriously by Indian philosophers as should have been taken. He often complained during personal conversations with me that nobody reads what I write. A very few Sanskritists and scholars like Professor R.C. Dwivedi and Pandit Badrinath Shukla took him seriously, as he acknowledges in dedicating Bhakti volume in introduction. So in my view, his contribution to Bhakti and initiation of the philosophical dialogue between a living tradition, a living religion, and philosophers is extremely, is exemplary, and we must carry it forward. The other point I would like to make is that Dayaji is normally considered to have an empiricist and rationalist stand in philosophy pursuit, and often he is considered as anti-religion. But now, not many people are aware of his writing on mysticism as back as in 1954, and his position on mysticism, religion and spirituality. In fact, I also read it very read these articles and his books very recently. He somehow did not talk or write much on religion or mysticism, maybe because usually people interpreted India's intellectual traditions as spiritual until recently. Amartya Sen, Sen's book Argumentative Indian, and Dayaji would never follow the usual path. He was compulsive path breaker and path maker, but he was always fascinated by the spiritual traditions of India, and he recognized their multifaceted contributions in other fields such as art, music, dance, architecture, etc., about which he has written extensively. Dayaji, in his article, A Religious Experience, Language and Truth, which was written in 1961, says, I quote, the language in which religious experience tends to express itself is not the language of mathematics or even of empirical sciences, but of parables and paradox, which still claims to convey truth. I repeat, which still claims to convey truth. And then comparing the experimental aspect with scientific truths asks the question, then why should the religious experience be treated on a different level or as cognitively in different category than these experiences? He argues that mystic experiences is a human experience, and there's no realm of human experience which is completely unintelligible to any mind provided it is open and within quote open towards it. So we just have to be open. And if you're open, then it will be intelligible. And if it is intelligible, then it is a part of experience. And if it's an experience, then it should be actually part of the cognitive enterprise. So this is his argument. So there he concludes, mystic experiences must also be intelligible. There he realizes the importance of bhakti and puts it in the category of purushartha. He makes it a focal point of discussion as it is one of the most important examples of mystic experience. He raises all sorts of fundamental questions regarding the experience and meaning of bhakti. So he's not only raising theoretical, logical and conceptual inquiries into mystic experience, but also going deep into the question of experiencing religion. In his article, Did Gopis Really Loved Krishna? Raises many fundamental questions and concludes, knowing, feeling and willing are these primary modes of consciousness. Bhakti is in the field of feeling. No ideal can ever be achieved completely. It always remains a matter of discovery. Dayaji, in his article, Bhakti, the new Purushartha, the tide wave from South, points out that the debate between Advaitin and the non-Advaitin was a debate concerned with a new movement in the spiritual life of India, which became famous with the emergence of the Srimad Bhagavad Gita in the South. A new approach to a relationship with God, bhakti, and a new form of spirituality was emphasized. The basic idea was that it was feeling and emotion which alone could reveal the truth and establish living relationship with God as against intellect or reason. Ultimate reality is identified with rasa as a word which was centered to Indian thought about art and aesthetics, which suggested a close analogy between the two. Going deep into the questions, he started a dialogue with practitioners, including Acharya Srivats Goswamiji, which is called as Bhakti Samvad, which is published in the form of a book. The book is called Bhakti, A Contemporary Discussion. Today, we have amongst us Acharya Srivats Goswamiji addressing some of these issues and related issues in his lecture. Let me invite Acharya Srivats Goswamiji to present his thought before us on the subject. Once again, I'm overwhelmed by your presence, especially by being Sunday. We hope to have interesting discussions and interactions after the lecture. With these few words, on behalf of the Krishna Academic Foundation and Society for Philosophical Praxis, Counseling and Spiritual Healing, Jaipur, once again, I welcome each one of you to this small but memorable event. Thank you so much. Over to Professor Sinha, please.
Oh, I request Swamiji to deliver his lecture.
Thank you, Ashaji, and thank you, Professor Sinha. कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय परे परमात्मने प्रणतक्लेशनाशाय गोविंदाय नमो नमः। सर्वप्रथम समस्त गुरुजनों का जो आज मेरे ऊपर कृपा करने के लिए यहाँ उपस्थित हैं, उनका अभिवादन और उनका सम्मान करते हुए, उनको प्रणति निवेदन करते हुए और सभी उपस्थित बंधुओं से वृंदावन के तर्ज पर राधे राधे करते हुए मैं निवेदन करना चाहूँगा कि मेरी अकेली प्रार्थना से काम शायद आज नहीं चलेगा, आप सबकी समवेत प्रार्थनाएं मुझे चाहिए, क्योंकि लीला धाम वृंदावन में, कृष्ण की लीला के धाम वृंदावन में आज इंटरनेट अपनी कुछ प्रकट और अप्रकट होने की लीला बड़ी तीव्रता से कर रहा है, तो आप आशीर्वाद दीजिए, प्रार्थना कीजिए कि इंटरनेट स्थिर होके, लेट्स प्रे फॉर द कंटिन्यूड कनेक्टिविटी. वेल, व्हाई आई एम हियर दिस इवनिंग, फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल, whatever has to be said about the subject has been succinctly and beautifully put forward by Asha ji. So my presence is redundant. But I am here yatha niyuktosmi tatha karomi, in compliance with the orders of Asha ji again, which I accepted in due humility as an occasion to make some offerings to a great Indian mind, Professor Daya Krishnanji. But I soon realized that I have nothing to offer, totally deprived of any intellectual or analytical resources. And these are not the word of humility. You will soon realize this as I dare to proceed. Anyway, Asha ji did not allow me to drag my feet when she ordered me to do this seva. And almost after 2 years, I am here on the basis of the blessings I received from Professor Daya Krishnanji himself. His kindness always manifested in the form of a unique gift, which I received whenever I met him. There was never a conversation with him which would not trigger a question. I recollect here one such gift in his precious words, and I quote him. It was sometimes in 1987 that Sri Vatsa told me about the attempt of Chaitanya and his disciples to recast all knowledge in the perspective of bhakti. I had not known of the attempt, nor even those who are interested in the tradition. And Professor Daya Krishnan continues to point out that there seems to be an essential difference. There was an emphasis on intellectuality that generally seems to be missing in the anti-intellectual emotionalism that is so often associated with bhakti. And hence, it seems worth exploring further to find whether there was really an intellectual dimension of the bhakti tradition. Wasn't a contradiction in terms, unquote. But with his blessings, this evening we shall explore why do we feel shy of allowing bhakti as a philosophical concept. Rather, we presume that it is basically a religious idea which we want to reflect upon. In doing this inadvertently, we have carried a mindset, what philosopher Richard Rorty says, this mindset is a product of 300 years of rhetoric about the importance of distinguishing sharply between science and religion, science and politics, science and art, science and philosophy, and so on. This rhetoric has formed the nature of Europe and made the West what it is today, unquote. I must confess at the outset that I am not equipped for this exploration. However, with the grace of my two other gurus, Professor T. R. V. Murthy and Professor J. L. Mehta, I shall try to make some offerings to Professor Dayakrishnan. And I begin with reminding myself about the term darshana, which of course is derived from the root drish. And when we put the lut suffix, we get the word darshana. And the root drish, to see, can be understood in various ways. In the Bhavavachya, drisher bhavaha darshanam, the seeing itself, darshanam, seeing. Or in the Kartari Vachya, darshayati iti darshanam, one who shows, where the lut pratyaya becomes lu pratyaya because it is a masculine word then. And in the Karmani Bhava, drishyate yat tad darshanam, that which is seen. And then in the Karane, drishyate anena iti darshanam, by which it is seen. So with these facility given by one word called darshan, we move that darshan thus operates in the domains of philosophy as well as religion. In Heidegger's opinion, the root problem with Western thought lies in the seemingly unimportant separation of being with thinking. In Indian rhetoric, religious darshan handles being and philosophical darshan focuses on thinking, if we can borrow loosely Heidegger's terminology. Tradition also emphasizes upon the need to overcome the duality of science and wisdom. And in Bhagavad, Krishna says, Jnanam param guhyam me yat vijnan samanvitam. And on that line, one of the finest Indian mind of the last century, Professor J.L. Mehta, tells us that we in India, I quote him, we in India may consider ourselves lucky in having an extraordinary rich legacy of non-representational yet stringent discursive thought, which never fell out of the dimension of the holy. This is very interesting and challenging statement he is making when he says, stringent discursive thought which never fell out of the dimension of the holy. However, Professor Mehta warns that we shall have to make our rhetoric, I quote him, meaningful to modern scientific thought. Our rhetoric should be meaningful to modern scientific thought as not something alien, but rather part of our present reality. The West within us, the Indians, the transforming reality or rhetoric into reality requires hard labor of thought, of turning reflection into verbal articulation, of creative self-interpretation, without which fruitful conversation between the Western and the Indian within us cannot be carried on. The conversation is essentially between the questing adventure of science and the love of wisdom. Indian philosophers have religiously worshipped and adored only one God. As Rigved says, Yo Devanam Namadha Ek Eva Tam Samprishnam Bhuvna Yant Anya. That our only God is a Samprishna, a total questioning, and a proper questioning is our God par excellence. In this spirit of creative self-interpretation, we are engaged in conversation on the larger theme of Bhakti Mimamsa, focusing upon the two queries raised by Professor Dayakrishnan. First of which is the general question to find whether there was really an intellectual dimension of Bhakti tradition in India. It's a very general and fundamental question he is raising. To find whether there was really an intellectual dimension of Bhakti tradition in India. And second, more specific one, that I quote him, it was not Krishna that the gopis loved, but they were in love with the love they felt for him. They never loved Krishna. My God. So, why bhakti? Why shall we come back to bhakti in an intellectual conversation? I again hear Professor Mehta saying, I quote him, bhakti is the bedrock on which man stands and moves in his endeavor to live and understand life. To act morally in its conduct and come to terms with the perturbations of heart that his flesh is heir to, the ground on which its variegated forms and expressions have their play, unquote. Moreover, our enterprise of thinking about bhakti also comes from Professor Dayakrishnan's inspiring, or rather challenging words. His inspiring words were always problematic because they put forth more problematic and challenging situations. He said, supposing there is no literal evidence, and it's very significant what he's saying. Supposing there is no literal evidence about the philosophical aspect of bhakti, can we not start a philosophical tradition of thinking now? And that is what makes Dayakrishnan Dayakrishnan. Forget that till now, when he's talking in the late 80s or early 90s, that till then there is no philosophical tradition about bhakti. But he says, can we start the enterprise? Can we take the challenge? So, with that challenge, very humbly, I can begin. What is this bhakti as the bedrock of human life? It has been said, Suparnam vipra kavyoho vacho bhir ekam santam bahuda kalpayanti. Bhakti is an idea, a concept. But which form and expression of bhakti's variegated play are we going to enjoy in this brief presentation this evening? And that launches us in my very disjointed effort, where I shall try to capture the Vedantic viewpoint of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his school of thought about this concept of bhakti. Chaitanya probably had heard Professor Dayakrishnan challenging words. Suppose there is no literal evidence about the philosophical, can we not start a philosophical tradition of thinking now? And in response to Dayakrishnan, Chaitanya himself propounds thus. Don't go by chronology, go by concepts. The absolute. The Brihat Vastu Brahman is Bhagawan, the absolute truth. All the Vedas relate to Bhagawan as the Sambandhi Tattva. And this is Chaitanya's technical terminology. And the forms of bhakti, like Shravana, Kirtana, Smarana, Pada, Sevanam, etc., are all means of gaining, relating with Bhagavan Krishna. And thus, these forms of bhakti are called abhidheya, the means. From sadhana bhakti, the means, bhakti as a means, sprouts the prema bhakti at the feet of Krishna. And from it, one gains the rus of happiness of serving Krishna. That loving service is pancham purushartha, sei prema mahadhon, is the prayojan tattva, is the sambambonam, is the prayojan tattva. Sambandhi tattva is Bhagavan, abhidheya tattva is bhakti, and prayojan tattva is again bhakti, which is pure love for Krishna. These three, sambandha, abhidheya, and prayojan, fully cover the philosophical discourse, Chaitanya says. The darshanik mimamsa is fully covered by these three concepts. So now, let us see how. Mysteries all around. And these mysteries trigger quest in human mind. What is it all about? Who has done it? Why is it all there? And so on and so forth. Right from the Vedic times. The wondering and the questioning mind has triggered the process of thinking. This search for meaning of life for Chaitanya is a second order question. The primary question for him is, who is searching? Who is searching? Meaningfully, all the searches begin with oneself. Atmanam satatam vidhi. As we directly encounter ourselves, however vaguely it might be, we are assured that we are. We cannot negate our existence, astitva. So the first thing which emerges about ourselves is that we are sat. And our being is meaningful only till we are conscious and aware about that existence. A comatized existence is worse than death. So the second quality emerges, that we are aware, we are conscious, we are chit. Then if we are aware and conscious, then the trouble begins. Why are we? Why are we? What is the agenda? Agenda definitely universally is yatobhyudaya nishreyas siddhi. That is the agenda of the humankind. To be free from pain and suffering. So that agenda gives us the final characteristic of ourself, ananda. We are seeking ananda. We are sukh mukhiya. But the question still remains. Despite us being of the Sat, Chit and Anand nature, why do we suffer? Why are we suffering? Suffering then for Chaitanya lies in not realizing that worldly wealth, goodies and persons in themselves are not the source of happiness. Rather, it lies in our relationship with them. Wherever we are seeking happiness, those goodies, those resources, those people do not have the capacity to radiate happiness. Rather, it is the gift of our relationship with them which makes us happy. And we are happy to the degree we relate with. But when our relation with these things is snapped, the experience turns into pain. And that's why they say, na alpena sukham. Whenever there is a punctuation, wherever there is a full stop, the experience of happiness turns into a painful experience. Yovai bhuma tadeva sukham. So then at that point, the journey begins from limited to the unlimited, from transitory to the eternal. What and how shall we relate with? Kasmai devai havisha vidhema. Kasmai devai. Chaitanya says there are two ways to find out. First, intellectually vaya negativa. Neti neti. Swayam vam devar dev eva. Maya mayatva anusandhanena. We explore the maya mayatva nature of the phenomena. So what happens then? Essentially focus upon what is not. In the path of philosophical analysis, the realization of our limitation is the threshold of our awareness of the unlimited. Reason or logic, etc., do not create the intellectual, the infinite or the eternal reality. The reason merely removes doubts, asambhavana, and the conflicting views, the viparita bhavana, about it. Thus, the ultimate is revealed through reason and intellectual enterprise. In the second alternative way, we dig deeper into the given. And this experiential journey is the path of religion, a journey within. Anushthitena yogenava. Whatever is already given and accomplished, you dig deeper into it. That is the path of religious inquiry. So in that way, then Chaitanya says, vadanti tattat vidastattvam yajnanam ajvayam. The result of all intellectual enterprise in the realm of reality takes us to the knowledge of tattva, the reality, as non-dual absolute. He uses the term advaya tattva, not advaita tattva. And there's a tremendous ramification between the two. Advaya tattva. He somehow prefers to ignore the metaphysical advaita of Shankara and chooses Nagarjuna's epistemological category of advaya. Anyway, we will come back to that later. Further, that non-dual absolute manifests variously. Satyam, Jnanam, Anantam, Brahma is the core result of the philosophical inquiry or the starting point of philosophical inquiry in the Indian tradition. Satyam, Jnanam, Anantam, Brahma. Or in Chaitanya's terminology, vadanti tattat vidastattvam yajnanam advayam brahmeti paramatmeti bhagavan iti shabdete.
etc., etc. So the question is, why is the absolute expressed variously when it is essentially non-dual? Why this various manifestations and expressions about it? Are they synonyms or anuvad of each other? Then if they are anuvad of each other, then they are redundant. And this redundancy will be a fallacy. And if they are exclusive manifestations, then the absolute will lose its non-duality. The Chaitanyas understand this variety of absolute in these words. They say, Ath evam advaya jnana lakshanam tat tattvam. Advaya jnana lakshanam tattvam. Samanyatayo lakshitva punaha upasak yogyata vaisheshtyena prakatita nijasatta vishesham. Although it is a non-dual knowledge, the absolute is just a non-dual knowledge. It's very challenging terminology he is using. And this is the general first primary definition of samanyato lakshetva. What lakshetva? Advaya jnana lakshanam tat tattvam. But that absolute, non-dual absolute, upasak yogyata vaisheshtyena prakatita nijasatta vishesham. It manifests variously because of the difference in the upasak yogyata, who is seeking. The seeker's variety causes the non-dual absolute to manifest variously. So the Vedantic concept of Sat Chit Anand and the paths of Jnana, Karma and Bhakti Yogas, etc. is never missing from the discourse of traditional Indian philosophy. This discourse got its contemporary avatar in the dense and analytical thoughts of Professor K.C. Bhattacharya. For our purposes, Professor T.R.V. Murthy, being unaware of the Chaitanya's analysis of this subject, elaborates it for our understanding in his classic essay, Knowing, Willing, and Feeling as Functions of Consciousness in 1934. And I'm tempted to share a few lines from him. And it says, I don't know where we are with time.
There's no problem. I think you can go ahead, please. You can go ahead, please. Hello.
Please.
Words of Murthy who say,
please continue.
We start with an thanks. We started two entities, consciousness and content. Content and this object in any sense, the present, some being, feeling, maybe see as most of. Tend to the object as of relation of attention, or there can be three gaps between consciousness and content. One in which the content remains the mode of action, attention is, as it were, entirely lost in the object and not vice versa. Or second, in which consciousness determines the content and not vice versa. Or thirdly, that in which the determination is either way. If the third alternative is not to be a real repetition of the former two, it must mean that attention and consciousness mutually determine each other. That is, the determination is not separately distinguishable and I'm adding the word achintya, the whole thing is indeterminate. Fourthly, it might be that neither is the other. Two things are separate and uncontained, the consciousness and the content. But this turns down all relations. The two things for ascension, and we cannot speak of them, this pure agnosticism. It says, our a priori has given three, three modes of relation between consciousness and content. These can be being, willing, and feeling respectively. Unquote. Following the path of philosophical analysis, the Chaitanyaites understand that our psychological makeup conditions our quest and our path. Upasaka yogyata vaishishtyena. The paths are thus classified as cognitive, cognitive, and emotive. In the cognitive aspect, the status is objective. Jnanam tu vastu tantram. And the path is knowledge, and the goal is sat, the absolute as sat, pure being. If the aspect is cognitive, then the status is subjective, where it is param ahanta in the form of Vijnanvada or Kashmir Shaivism or other ways, where the will is predominant and the path is karma, nishkama karma, vairagya, etc. And the goal is chitta. And if our aspect of reality and the absolute is emotive, then subject and object both are available to us, and the path is the path of feeling, of bhakti, and the goal is ananda. Hence, these alternative natures of absolute as sat, chit, and ananda, they are not translations of each other, but they are alternatives based upon the path by which we seek to relate to the absolute. This analysis is the moment of epiphany in not only the Indian, but human history, where the three unique dimensions of the ultimate reality are revealed as Sat, Chit, and Ananda. And it is also evident from this analysis that in the paths of knowledge and will, relation is not possible. Relation, however, can't be discarded as it is a fact of experience. It is only in the feeling mode that the relation is not only available, but it is presupposed. From there, we may move to the search for the Sambhambhunam. The Purusharth. What is the Purusharth? That state of Nishreyasa Siddhi is the state of happiness beyond any sufferings. Because for happiness, we seek relationships. Rather, we cannot discount relation if we are searching for happiness. Nature and function of relation is to bring two, the subject and object, together. A look at the human phenomena reveals that the variety of relationships are functioning in the human experience, which then we classify in our understanding as Dasya Bhava, the professional relationships, Vatsalya Bhava, the filial kind of relationships, Sakya Bhava, friendships of different kinds, and Madhurya Bhava, the amorous relationships, the most intimate. And in these categories of relationships, classification of relationship, we find that there is a hierarchy which is determined by the barometer of intimacy and immediacy. The intimacy available in the professional relationships is lesser than the Vatsalya Bhava. The Vatsalya Bhava is less intimate than the Sakya Bhava, and Sakya Bhava is less intimate than the Madhurya Bhava. So intimacy and immediacy is the barometer of the quality of a relationship. So in that way, the Kanta Bhava, the amorous mode of relationship in the Madhurya Bhava, includes and transcends all other relationships in the human arena. So on the basis of the phenomenology of relationship in the human sphere, the Chaitanyas say that having the relation established, the concern that is towards the process of sustaining it, how do we sustain relation? If you want to sustain our ananda, the nishreyas, the parama purushartha. For that, the means par excellence is service, seva. And bhaj sevayam dhatu bhakti, seva or bhakti. Bhakti vina jagatere nahi avasthan. Chaitanya made this bold statement that this world will collapse without the concept of bhakti. It's a bedrock. What Professor Mehta said, the bhakti is the bedrock of humanity. Chaitanya is repeating those words of Mehta. I don't know where Professor Mehta taught Chaitanya, if not vice versa. So what kind of bhakti? Definitely not the one done for the sake of showing off or perform under duress, but bhakti or seva, which is performed out of love. Prema bhakti is the bhakti par excellence. So any seeker on the path of prema bhakti, as delivered by philosophical analysis, has to benefit from the experience of the realized ones. We require sakshat krita dharmana rishyaha, one who has seen firsthand, because rishir darshanat, we need the firsthand experienced person to tell us what prema bhakti is all about and why. This is a natural requirement of human being. Indispensability of learning from a living teacher. Humans do not accomplish anything which they have not learned. We live as much as we learn. And that's why the Bhagavad says, Gurur anugrahenaiva puman purna prashantaye. If you want total peace and total ananda, then Gurur Anugrahenaiva, the focal point of Hindu spirituality, is Waheguru. Waheguru. One who switches us on the path of search and realization. Then under Guru's guidance, we require to learn to do Premamayi Seva. And thus, that discipline of learning to do seva is called Vedi Bhakti, the injunctional or grammatical devotion. Learning grammar is a human predicament in any sphere of our experience or expression, from mundane to the spiritual. Therefore, the ninefold classification of Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu, Smaranam, Padasevanam, Archanam, Vandanam, Dasyam, Sakhyam, Atmanivedanam, culminating in the total merger of one's being into the universal being or the universal Sat, Chit, and Ananda. Sarva Dharman Parityajya Mam Ekam Sharanam Braja. That is the ultimate bhakti. So a seeker thus purified can search for the mysteries. Now, what is the mystery of the total union, that yoga? So when we move as a jnana yogi, then the objective Brahma is our realization, which Chaitanya is saying, vadanti tat tat vidastattvam yajnanam advayam brahmeti parmatmeti bhagavan iti shabdate. These are the alternatives available to us. Alternatives. They are not interchangeable. So, if you are jnana yogi, then you realize the objective Brahman. If you are a karma yogi, then you realize the subjective Paramatma, the Paramahanta. And if you are a bhakti yogi, then you realize Bhagavan, where the subject and object are dancing together. So, from the perspective of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, a seeker cherishes the ultimate experience as Bhagavan, which is a perfect union of the substance, Ananda, and its blissful potency, Ahladini Shakti, Krishna and Radha, Purush and Prakriti, male and female. In this ultimate relationship, Prema Bhakti, the loving service itself is the goal. Bhakti transcends being a means, it becomes the goal itself, when the means turns into the goal. And I'm reading for that a very significant statement explaining this from Professor Murthy again, where he says, true and effective relationship is indeed manifested out of love, prema bhakti, and in that mode the focus is upon the welfare of the other to whom we are connected in love. And that's where we are touching to the challenge given by Professor Dayakushan: did gopis love Krishna? Did gopis love Krishna? When we say that in prema bhakti the focus is upon the welfare of the other to whom we are connected in love. Fortunately, seekers on the path of prema bhakti, as illuminated by philosophical analysis, can also benefit from the experience of those who have trodden the path before us. Once again, the analysis provided by Professor Murthy is helpful in getting a sense of what is involved. He writes about feeling in general, but what he says is applicable to the felt phenomena of prema bhakti. What is the phenomena to whom we are offering the bhakti? And I quote Professor Murthy, in feeling, is feeling known? Is feeling known? Question mark. Feeling is not known, and this is for two reasons. Feeling is not an object existing by itself, an accomplished fact, which we only view calmly and dispassionately. There cannot be feeling if such a detachment or distinction is made between consciousness and content. Secondly, the difference between feeling, if it were objectified, and knowledge would not be a functional or coordinate difference, for feeling would be a species of object as red or the table, and not a mode of relation between consciousness and content. The difference between feeling and the table would be sought to be made on the ground that the latter is an outer object while the former is an inner subject, inner one. But this one distinction of the inner and the outer would involve feeling. We call that inner with which we are identified intimately and perhaps inseparably. The essence of feeling is not its unreflective character, which may be its limiting case, but the comparative non-distinction between consciousness and content. This is available as in a reflective state also. A reflective feeling can be defined as that state in which we feel and at once to be aware of it as feeling are not distinct or distinguishable. It might be seen that feeling is more primitive and basic than the other two, that is knowing and willing. Feeling is thicker. So this metaphysical ontological reality by the Upanishads as two lovers could be consumed in prema bhakti. Yatha leva sita saparishto na dam kuchve na anadhar difference. In that intense moment, let's transcend their separate identity into the non-duality of the experience. Here, the duality of mainstream, etc., is never denied. Yet, there emerges a feeling, that is the discourse of love, where the consciousness of the two transcends reality and forms into non-dual consciousness. So reflection on this experience provides us with a new system of logic, difference in non-difference, bheda-bheda. And it's not a new thing in the Indian tradition. Chaitanya is not doing something new, but what he says is very important. Aparetu tarka pratishthanat iti nyayena bhedepi abhedepi nirma nirmaryada doshantanti darshanena. The fallacy of infinite regress or begging the question, bhinnatvena chintayantum ashakyatvat abhedam sadhayantaha tad yad abhinayatayapi chintayantum ashakyatvat bhedam api sadhayantum. The bhed establishes abheda and abheda establishes bheda. So he says, achint bhed abhed vadam svikarvantu swamatetu achint bhed abhedau eva achint shakti mayatvat. So this bhed and abhed together seems inconceivable. And of course it does. But only from the point of view of the logic of binary opposites. If we see from the point of view of fuzzy logic, then it makes perfect sense. Logic, however, should conform to a fact of experience. Relation and love are facts of experience and life. However achint or mystical it might appear to the fettered reasoning of binary opposites, the inconceivable difference in non-difference, achint bheda bhed vad, is the logic of love and mysticism. Indian thought and spirituality calls that aesthetic experience as rasa, raso vai saha. This aesthetic experience or rasanubhuti is described by the Chaitanyaites as vidvat rahasya anubhava, a mystical experience of the accomplished. Traditionally speaking, ras is an experience in asampragyat samadhi, distinctionless state of mind, mukha swadanvat, advayatva. However, there are processes in place to express the inexpressible. And this is where Chaitanya makes, transgresses the limitations of tradition. What Vyakrishna always says, are we willing to transgress? Because that transgression is the evolution. So Chaitanya takes the bait and he says, Vedas, Upanishads, Yoga Shastra, Natya Shastra, Rasa Shastra, poetry, music, dance, all these are humble yet honest attempts of translating the intuitive experience through language of the discursive realm. This is an act of karuna, compassion, a great service to humanity, which Professor Mehta summarizes, and I quote him, understood in this metaphysical, non-psychological sense of feeling, prema bhakti, loving devotion, represents man's primordial relationship to being. It is the supreme privilege of man's mortal state and the ultimate refuge in his search for the wholeness and for being healed. So in view, we find that out of the three alternate spiritual paths of Jnana, Karma, and Bhakti, last one is appropriately called in the Bhagavat Mahatmya as the mother of two. Bhakti as the mother of Jnana and Vairagya. What is that meaning? In the words of Professor T.R.B. Murthy, feeling is more basic and primitive than the other two, knowing and willing. Feeling is a thicker concept. Bhakti is a thicker path, thicker idea, thicker reality. Bhakti includes both the subjective and the objective reality and transcends them in a mystical union. There is no awareness of the duality of any kind. Bhakti is the means for excellence for a spiritual realization. Done. But a question arises that how does this bhakti dance in this mundane world? And that brings me to my final section, a short one. I'll not deprive you of your dinner tonight. Bhakti to use mankind had to have body, mere philosophy, philosophical idea or a doctrine. T.R.B. Murthy says, however, one should not overrate the part between scholarship and theoretical understanding of things in the task of regeneration. He warns that history does not record a single instance of a spiritual revelation of global dimensions brought out by a band of scholars and skillful thinkers. The melody of the world is far too universal and deep-seated for remedies to be prescribed directly from the book. Unquote. And it is so true what he says. That can happen only when it is practiced, not only as means of realization, as an abhidheya, but also as a prayojana, loving devotion, as a goal itself. Bhakti as a goal in itself. One such example is Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who personified bhakti as an idea, as means, and as the all three together. She then regards the incarnation of Radha and male and divine human, the goals and means, the seeming opposites residing in one body. Radha Bhava Suddham Nami Krishna Swarupam, that is the worship of Chaitanya, that he is the composite form, inseparable both manifestation of Radha and Krishna in one body, Advaya Bhava. Here, अचिंत भेदा भेद पर्सनिफाइड एज चैतन्य. I don't know if you can still hear me because the internet is playing.
We can listen.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we can hear you, but there are some disturbances. Maybe you can...
Can I take another 5 minutes? 5 minutes?
Yes, please, go ahead. Go ahead. I would request you to switch off the video. I think we'll have a better sound.
Okay. So when we were talking about Chaitanya as a personification of the category, the thought category of Achinta Bheda Abheda, his activities are life affirming, which include philosophizing to dancing, and that way relating and always serving the humanity with love. He's totally grounded in tradition, yet adds new dimension to the philosophical discourse and his spiritual discourse. He not only liberates the logical mind from the boundaries of binary opposites, bhed and abhed, he also reviews the Chatur Varga scheme of fourfold summum bonum and adds prema bhakti as the supreme summum bonum, prema pamartho mahan. That prema bhakti is the summum bonum par excellence. And he says, Chirakal ami nahi kari prema bhakti dan. Why? Because it was a very difficult concept. The mind was not ready to accept the seemingly contradictory concept of Achinta Bheda Bhedvad. And without that logical evolution, growth, the concept of prema bhakti pancham purusha was not possible. So first the mind has to be ready, then the heart will work in sync with that. So purushart, he says, is param tattva sakshatkar kshanam.
आवाज नहीं आ रही, सही आवाज,
इंटरनेट. कैन यू हियर मी नाउ?
यस, नाउ वी
कैन. यू हियर मी नाउ?
यस, वी कैन हियर यू प्लीज.
ओके
यस, इट इज ओके नाउ.
ही सेज कि जो परम तत्व से साक्षात्कार है, उसका जो ज्ञान है, उस साक्षात्कार जो ज्ञान है वह परम पुरुषार्थ है, परमानंद प्राप्ति. और उस ज्ञान के भीतर ही परमानंद की प्राप्ति है, और सैव परम पुरुषार्थ इति, और वही परम पुरुषार्थ है. विद दिस ग्रोथ ऑफ द ट्रेडिशन, ए ग्रोथ ऑफ द शास्त्र परंपरा वॉज बेटर. The four Vedas are now not sufficient in the domain of Pancha Purusharthas. That's why the fifth Ved is required. And the Prasthanatray concept is liberated. All Prasthanatrays are now confined and included and transcended by Srimad Bhagavat Purana. I hope my voice has discontinued again.
No, we can hear you, please. Go ahead.
Okay, wonderful. So now we need a Panchamabhya, which is a natural commentary on Brahma Sutra, Artham Brahma Sutranam, and Sarva Vedanta Saramhi, which is a natural commentary and concise presentation.
We can't hear.
Yeah.
We cannot hear. No voice.
And moreover, it should conclude now.
Yeah, I think it should conclude. Yeah. Maybe he's trying to come back. What should we do? Let me try to get in touch with him, and maybe he should finish if he can't join us. Just give me a minute, please.
Asha ji. So, you are not audible.
I don't know where I was hurt.
Hopefully, you can conclude it.
I will just conclude and repeating that in this Achint Bheda Bhed Vedanta of Chaitanya and his followers, it engages us not just in the discourse of philosophy. Its aesthetic inclusiveness provides a framework for a dialogue between various viewpoints in social and political fields as well. On the Rasmandal of Bhakti, supported by the inclusive Achint Bheda Bhed category, every viewpoint is welcome to dance, but with a condition. Sri Chaitanya warns, if you are humbler than a blade of grass, if you are forbearing like a tree, if you do not care for your ego and pride, and if you are not willing to respect, and if only you are willing to respect others, then only one can sing and dance in the theater of Prema Bhakti. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Acharya Shivats Goswami ji. Professor Sinha, please take over and invite the questions.
Hopefully, we have got hardly half an hour. So a few questions we can invite. So anyone? Professor D. Gangadhar, hopefully.
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Thank you, Professor Sinha, you have given me the opportunity to speak on this prestigious lecture. I'm so much delighted to listen about Veda Bhed and Achintya Veda Bhed distinction. So regarding this, I have a very small clarification by the great speaker that what is the difference between Veda Bhed Prema Bhakti and Achintya Veda Bhed.
Sinha sir, can I ask something? Professor Sinha sir, am I audible?
Yeah, I think we can take all the questions together.
I would like to ask.
I think. Pikaji,
I am very much delighted by listening the very serious lecture of Goswamiji. But I would like to know that Professor Dayakrishna was aware about the reconstruction which was started by Krishna Bhattacharya and developed by Yari Murthy in the form of knowing model of Advaita, reading model of Advaita and feeling model of Advaita. Though he was aware about this reconstruction, then why he has made a harsh comment on the philosophy of bhakti that it cannot be considered as a proper work of reason? My first question is this. And my second question is not a question at all, but rather a clarification that Professor Murthy, in his famous article, Knowing, Willing and Feeling, a tripartite function of mind, and many times quoted by Goswamiji, that Professor Murthy has considered that feeling model of Advaita is more basic than knowing model of Advaita and willing model of Advaita. I am little bit confused here that though Professor Murthy holds that three model of Advaita is an unreducible model between each other. They cannot be reduced between two, and even there is no question for hierarchy between three logical model of Advaita. Then how Professor Murthy called that feeling model of Advaita is more basic, rather thicker? I would like to clarification on this point from a very, very learned disciple of Yari Murthy, Sri Goswamiji. Thank you.
So, Professor Gangadhar, you want to say something more?
To this question raised by Professor Ambika Dutt, I would just suggest I should make some query regarding knowing, feeling and willing model. Actually, in fact, Professor Murthy, whatever he has written about, that is just from Kesi Bhattacharya's three alternative forms of absolute. This is the level of consciousness on which the concept of absolute can be constructed. Knowing aspect, willing aspect and feeling aspect. Professor Murthy is very correct while dealing with feeling as an highest model of knowing absolute. Thank you very much. And the first question I raised about Achinta Bheda Ved and Bheda Ved regarding Prema Bhakti. Thank you.
Ashaji, can we invite one more question? One more question.
Yes, I suppose you can invite the question, but I'm not sure whether Acharya
Goswami
is with us.
No, I'm not very much there.
Oh, okay.
I'm very much here. Okay. But I lost my video because of the poor connectivity.
Yeah, right. That, no, I'm thankful to you. Yeah, I couldn't see your face, so I was wondering. Yes. All right, great. So I think we can take up all the questions one after another, and then maybe we can request Acharya Ji to reply at the end, so that we can have more questions, and maybe some of them might be having common concern, you know.
Okay. So we welcome questions. I think Professor Sharad Deshpande ji is visible. So, everybody have some comments or some observations?
Dr. Pankaj Basotia wants to say something, I suppose. Yes, Pankaj ji, go ahead.
मुझे बहुत अच्छा लगा जो सर का लेक्चर था. तो एक बात जो सीधे उनके लेक्चर से संबंधित नहीं है पर फिर भी भक्ति को लेकर मेरे मन में रही है हमेशा, उसको मैं उनके सामने रखना चाहता हूँ. वो ये है कि जैसे भगवत गीता के संदर्भ से खासकर जो उभरता है वो है कि ज्ञान कर्म और भक्ति में जैसे कोई परस्पर विरोध है. ये चीज एक बहुत ज्यादा उभारी गई है कि जैसे कर्म योग, ज्ञान योग और भक्ति योग अलग अलग है, पर अगर हम भक्ति को और ज्यादा गहराई में जाके देखें तो वहां ज्ञान कर्म का विरोध रहता नहीं है. भक्ति में एक तरीके से वो सब समन्वित हो जाता है. और
जी प्रश्न करें.
हाँ, प्रश्न पे ही मैं आ रहा हूँ. वो मेरा सीधी बात ये है कि आत्मज्ञान और भक्ति में मेरे ख्याल से तो शंकराचार्य और अद्वैत में भी एक प्रकार का संबंध देखा गया है, तो इस बारे में आचार्य वर्ग की राय क्या है? आत्मज्ञान और भक्ति परस्पर विपरीत है, विरोधी है, या उनमें भी कहीं एकता और समन्वय है? ये मेरा प्रश्न है.
सो यस, प्रोफेसर देशपांडे, डू यू लाइक टू गिव सम कमेंट्स और सम ऑब्जर्वेशंस?
No, of course, it was a very fascinating lecture, and all, especially the way the am I audible?
Namaskar, Deshpande ji.
The way Acharya ji has put the whole concept of bhakti in a perspective, that was very fascinating. And generally, people are stuck up in this dichotomy or trichotomy between gyan, bhakti, karma, and the same kind of questions keep they are repeatedly asked. I think we have to go a little further than this. But at one point, Acharya ji said that he will come back to a very fundamental distinction between Advaita and Advaya. So, but because of time constraint or maybe poor connectivity, this was not brought out little more. So I would urge Acharya ji to say a few more words about this distinction between Advaita and Advaya. It's not merely a terminological difference, I suppose, and the way Advaya, the concept of Advaya, seek to bracket the limitations of the concept of Advaita, I am interested more in listening on this particular point. Thank you.
Yeah. Hopefully, we can now.
Yeah, Professor Sinha, there's a question in the chat box by Lakshmi Narayan Lanka. He's asking, is there any technique of acquiring bhakti bhav which can be taught and learned? So this is the question. Anyway, I mean, we have to entertain the questions. Anybody else wants to raise a question? Just very briefly, please. Then we'll have the reply.
I have a brief question.
Yes, Ramaji. Ramaji, yeah. From Ravensar University. Yes, please.
I mean, just curious. I was curious to know. When we think of bhakti as a qualitative concept, there is this notion of this cognitive notion linked to bhakti. I see that when you have bhakti, then some you presuppose that there is a reality. But when you talk about bhakti as an a cognitive approach to understand reality, whether that can be really properly understood, that is the question I have trouble with. Maybe clarify there. That's all I want to say.
Okay.
So the point is, when you talk about bhakti, there is as a cognitive approach, whether really, when you talk about bhakti, there is always a presupposition of reality. But bhakti as a mode of knowing the reality, understanding, is that possible? That's the question.
Yeah, Sinha Sahib, I suppose we can, ask for the speaker to.
Yes, please, yes. So, Swamiji should. Satyendra wants to ask one question. So, please, yes. This will be the last one. Yes, sir. Professor Dr. Satyendra Kumar from Delhi University.
Thank you so much, sir, for giving me an opportunity. It is a wonderful lecture, sir. As the lecture start from the reference of the Lord Krishna, and in Gita, in the philosophy of Gita, there is too much emphasis on the Nishkam Karma Yoga, and while mentioning the trio of TRV Murti, knowing, willing, and feeling. Is the action that is Nishkam Karma Yoga has any connection to the willing? That is my question. That is knowing we can correlate with Jnana Yoga, feeling can we correlate to the Bhakti Yoga, and willing can we relate it? This is my question. Willing, can we relate it to the Karma Yoga? That is my question, sir.
Thank you very much. Now we can request Sri Swamiji to reply.
Now it is evident
Swamiji,
why I was dragging. Thank you. Can you hear me now?
Yes, please. Most of the questions are relating to cognitive, and aesthetic aspects. Most of the questions.
My moment of dreadful experience has come. This was the moment why I was not coming forward to deliver this lecture, because I cannot handle it. But with your grace and with your karuna,
you handle pretty well.
With your karuna, I will try to do something.
See
how your questions, which come as a kind of blessings and points of understanding for myself in this subject. What is actually happening? The tradition of Chaitanya, except from 8 verses, he did not write anything. But he had a very definitive system of educating his school of thinkers. And he took personal pain for that. And he personally trained his thinkers called the 6 Goswamis. In different places, he traveled to South India to train one. He traveled to Banaras, traveled to Allahabad to train another one. And he gave his philosophical scheme to all his followers. And then these followers, what were they doing? they were doing lot of bhakti creativity. They were creating bhakti shastra, but they was also creating bhakti darshan. And for that, the magnum opus which came out is Shat Sandarbha. It is a Sandarbha Grantha where there is an elaborate analysis of the contemporary philosophical discourse in the Vedantic tradition. And for that matter, the chief editor of this group was trained under Madhusudan Vachaspati in the jargon of Navya Nyaya. So this Shat Sandarbha is written in the language and scheme of Navya Nyaya. So you will see that how Navya Nyaya and the Prema Pumartho Mahan Raso Vaisaha, Bhagwan as the Ras, how daring they do. So that means there is a conscious effort on their part to bring bhakti into the intellectual discourse. Intellectual discourse. They are talking about vachya vachakta, they are calling about preme, pramana, and all the set concepts of that time, of the 15th, 16th century. And they're responding and participating in them. Participating in them. So with that, but there is something very interesting happening. They're writing these philosophical treatises because they want to enter into a rational or intellectual dialogue with the milieu, the Vedantic milieu. But the interesting thing is that in the Mangalacharan of the Shat Sandarbha, the Goswami is right that this book of philosophical discourse, this Sandarbha Grantha, should not be seen by those who are not devoted fully to Krishna. And this to me is an enigma. Those who are already completely devoted to Krishna, why do they need a shastra anymore? And they're saying, Anyato tu shapator pitaha. They are under an oath not to look at my book. But still he does. These six volumes, Tattva Sandarbha, Bhagavat Sandarbha, Paramatma Sandarbha, Krishna Sandarbha, Bhakti Sandarbha, and Preeti Sandarbha, where they're talking about Sambandhi Tattva, Prayojan Tattva, and Abhidheya Tattva in these six volumes. At the end of the volumes, he says, Kshamaswa he kshamashila ayi gokula nandanaha. Why I'm asking your pardon? Yadi kvachit tarlayutam maya. In bringing Ras into the discursive realm of knowledge, if I have diluted your reality a bit, please pardon me. So they're aware that bringing feeling into the knowing domain have tremendous challenges. But it still can be done. As I read a passage of that, is the knowing of feeling possible? Murti says, and once possible. And that's why it is always beginning, the Goswamis are focusing upon Atma Gyan. They are not focusing upon Paramatma Gyan or Krishna Gyan, but they are talking about Atma Gyan, self-knowledge. And one of the questions was about, so this self-knowledge is what? It is cannot be reduced to the Advaitic self-knowledge. But this परम तत्व साक्षात्कार ज्ञानम, परम तत्व साक्षात्कार ज्ञान, द ज्ञान ऑफ अ डिफरेंट ऑर्डर, दैट एक्सपीरियंशियल अवेयरनेस, दैट इज परम पुरुषार्थ एंड दैट इज डिफरेंट फ्रॉम द ज्ञान मार्गी आत्मज्ञान. Here they say, जीवेर स्वरूप होए कृष्णेर नित्योदास. The eternal relationship with Krishna is the absolute, absolute reality. That cannot be questioned. So what is your existential status or metaphysical status or ontological status, if you like to put it in those terminologies, that either you are an object of Krishna also feels for the devotees, or you are a subject for the feeling, for the felt Krishna, where Krishna is the object. And this interchangeability is there. Subject and object, the Bhakt and Bhagwan, they can be interchangeably subjective-objective modes. But the eternal relationship cannot be questioned. So in that way, we can see that the feeling domain cannot be reduced to what you call the cognitive knowing domain, where Shankaracharya is a good example. Good example. In the cognitive domain, in the path of will, where Shiva as a Param Ahanta, where his essay as Persipai, if we can use a Western phrase, that it is all the srishti of your sankalpa. And sankalpa is the root of any karma. So definitely we can bring the cognitive dimension and relate it to the karma marga, if we can do that. Another thing which I see is, if I can borrow the terminology of Derrida, that what I am trying to see is not what someone copied from someone else, what Murti got from Chaitanya, that is not the question. Whether Vyakrishna was aware of Chaitanya is not the question. In all probability, they were all aware. But at least Vyakrishna has written that he was not aware of the philosophical treatises of the Chaitanya school. He writes that in his introduction to the Bhakti volume. So what we see here, there is testing and the word, which fascinates me, and the phrase they newly reach the Chaitanyaite stand reality and the philosophical analysis reach rather the sense being a of one other are enriching and another thing which I will also support, that jnana, karma, and bhakti, they are not concepts. They are opposites. But they are irreducible. They are unique in their way, in their own way. And that's what Chaitanya says, if you move on the path of jnana, the Advaya Tattva will reveal to you as Brahman. If you are on the path of Vairagya and Karma, the Advaya Tattva will reveal to you as Paramatman, Paramatman of the yogic tradition, where the Sankalpa Shakti is the predominant factor. And they cannot be reduced to one to another. They cannot be reduced. And similarly, the path of bhakti also cannot be. But interestingly enough, what Chaitanya says through Bhagavad Puran, that jnana and karma are the sons of mother bhakti. And that is where it is very striking when Murthy says that bhakti is a basic and primordial and a thicker concept. But we should not try to analyze bhakti from the point of view of, say, Shankarite Advaita Vedanta. And that's where Chaitanya is preferring to use the epistemological terminology of Advaya. And Chaitanya is not unaware of the Buddhistic tradition of thought. Because in North Bengal, there is a tremendous presence of the Buddhists in the 15th century. And Chaitanya and his company reintroduced those Buddhists into the Vaishnava tradition. They brought them back. Those Nedas and Nedis were brought back into the Hindu Vaishnava tradition. So when these people are moving back into the Vaishnava tradition, they are also bringing their baggage, their intellectual baggage with them. They are not coming empty-handed. So he prefers the epistemic terminology of Advaya of Nagarjuna, which is like a transcending terminology which transcends Chatushkoti Vinirmuktam. That kind of thing, you know. Rather than focusing on the Advaita metaphysical category of Shankara. Because for Chaitanya, that will be a limiting factor. The Advaita Tattva is Brahman. But when it manifests in many ways, then it is the non-dual Advaita Tattva, beyond any description. But the moment we take a viewpoint, it can be described either as Brahman or as Paramatman or as Bhagavan. Can we acquire bhakti, bhav? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. And there is no need to acquire bhakti because bhakti is your swabhava. It is your swabhava. You are born with it. What is to be done that the Vaimukhya, if you are Samukhya to Bhagavan, then you are in the state of Prema Bhakti. But if you are a Vimukh, if you are turned away from it, or the ultimate reality, the Advaya Tattva, Krishna, is not available to you because of the intervention of Maya Shakti, the Bahiranga Maya Shakti, then you have to remove those avaranas. And removing of the Maya will be bhakti manifestation. So there is the same dialectic of opposites are there. And the same principles work, which work in Advaita, or in Kashmir Shaivism or Vigyanvad, the same dialectic is working here. The same concept of Maya is also working there. In Advaita, subjective is Maya, and the relationship with the subjective is also Maya. In Vigyanvad and Kashmir Shaivism, objective is Maya and the relationship with the objective is also Maya. But in path of bhakti, thinking of reality as purely objective or purely subjective or two separated, all these three is Maya. All these three is Maya. There is also a concept of Maya. Maya mayatto anusandhanena eva. And that is what the whole philosophical discipline is all about. Maya mayatva anusandhanena eva. That in the state of prema bhakti, neither you are pure objective, nor you are purely subjective, nor you are unrelated subject-object coexisting. It is the relationship which consumes the being of the two and transcends it. And this is a challenging situation for the logical system operated through binary opposites, bhed and abhed. And bheda bhed was almost there, but they could understand that how these two contradictory categories can be there. For that, you need a philosophy or phenomenology of prema or aesthetics, a phenomenology of aesthetics, where you analyze that aesthetic experience and you see that the duality is not negated. The male and female are there. Nasoham Ramana, Nasoham Ramani. Duhujana Pesha. But both are there. Neither the female is negated, nor the male is negated. But in their union, Priya Priyaiva Samparishokta, in that tight embrace, they transcend femaleness into a non-dual consciousness. And that consciousness, fact, experience, however, cannot be supported by the logical system of binary opposites. For that, we need a different logic, which is supra-logical, achintya. Achintya khalu ye bhava na tantarkena yujaye. That cannot be resolved by binary opposites. So you need an alternate system of logic. And as Professor Muthi always used to say, there is not a single neutral logical system. It depends upon your intuitive experience and fundamental experience, which to understand it through perspective. So Chaitanya's experience of rasa can be understood only of chintya bheda bheda. Nachintya in the sense of that it is illogical or unintuitive. It is logical and it is in the realm of intellectual discourse. And that's the difference between bheda bhedavad and achintya bheda bhedavad. And the same thing operates about Bhagavat Bikwings, the Prasthanastra, Ramanuja Madhva, they are almost there. They are almost there respecting Bhagavat authority, but not quite. It takes a Chaitanya to establish Bhagavat as a text in itself, without using the crutches of Upanishads or Brahma Sutra or Gita or anything. That's why none of the Goswamis wrote any commentary, but in the Sandarbhas, they have given a beautiful commentary and beautiful system, that is for some other evening, Bhashya on the Chatusutri, like Bhamati. In the Bhagavat Sandarbha, they have given an elaborate Bhashya on the first four Brahma Sutras. So they are aware that they have to talk into the system and the jargon of the discourse of that time, but from their own perspective, which was the perspective of feeling or prema bhakti. So I do not know if I have left any point. Definitely, on the face of it, there can be no cognitive bhakti, but there can be an awareness of bhakti. It can be shared and expressed, even at the cost of diluting bhakti, kvachit tarlayutam maya, as the Goswami says, even at the cost of diluting feeling, you can bring bhakti in the discursive realm of knowledge. You can do that. I'm really grateful for you bearing me and blessing it gave me vision to go through and read decades after decades. I'm a completely non-academic person, but it was a sheer bliss. Pay my homage to Professor Dash and my lineage of that Swamis and gurus. Thank you, Ashaji, so much. Thank you, Professor Sinha, for being here and giving strength and courage.
Professor Sinha, can we have your presidential remarks, please?
Certainly. I offer my namaskar to each and everyone on the screen and off the screen. It will not be possible for me to name each and everyone, but certainly I am thankful to Professor Ashaji for asking me to chair this most prestigious lecture given by Sri Goswamiji. I'm thankful and thankful to all who participated in deliberation, and especially my old friend of BHU, Professor D. A. Gangadhar, and a senior person like Professor Deshpande. The presidential address prepares the ground for thanksgiving. But I will concentrate in brief one or two points. First, very important, I do not want to tax your patience anymore. Dr. Acharya Goswamiji has raised a very pertinent point can we contemplate that bhakti is a philosophical concept? Why we do not take bhakti as a philosophical concept? The question arises, because normally bhakti, with philosophizing, is conceptualizing, and he has rightly contemplated and that bhakti should be treated as a philosophical concept. But ordinarily, philosophers and even hopefully Asaji will tell, even Professor Dayakrishna could not endorse that bhakti is a philosophical concept. Because he was a very strict philosopher, and in the early phase of his life, philosophical, he despised the emotive concepts, and he is a rationalist, and Professor Asha Mukherjee has been the direct student. I have heard him lecturing, and so I can tell that he always talked in brief. He never talked. He talked briefly, but he always presented very. His thoughts were very full of philosophical depth. So naturally, today, this evening, we had a very illuminating talk on bhakti as a concept. So I will concentrate on 3 points very briefly, 1 or 2 sentences on each point. So first, the question of bhakti, the distinction between bhakti and mysticism, that cropped. Perhaps Asaji, while introducing the theme, talked about the distinction. So certainly bhakti cannot be treated as a mystical one. So in mysticism, we transcend the rational level in mysticism. So in mysticism, we are cut off from the rational level, but in bhakti we are not cut off. Bhakti certainly is a motive one, but it is not non-rational, whereas mysticism is, according to Rudolf Otto, is a non-rational one. So this is the one thing which I understood and which I can place before you. The second point is a very prominent point regarding cognitive, ponative, and aesthetic aspect. And Swamiji, Sri Vats Swamiji, Goswamiji, emphasized on the in the tune of Professor T.R. Murthy that feeling aspect is predominant. Certainly, when we talk about bhakti, the feeling aspect is predominant. So here, I would like to put before you that in Indian philosophy, or in Indian religion, we do not put emphasis on revelation. Rather, we put emphasis on self-realization. And when we talk about self-realization is the method to attain the ultimate goal or ultimate reality. So naturally, the feeling aspect is dominant in the ordinary parallels. For the common man, this bhakti is important, but for chosen philosophers, the cognitive aspect is important. But man has got 3 aspects, cognitive, ponative, and aesthetic, and they cannot be separated. They are integral. And certainly, Sri Aurobindo talks about integral experience. So the third point, and with this I will conclude, because I promise that I will not tax your patience. The limitation of Advaitism, and Swamiji, Goswamiji has made a distinction between Advaitism and Advaita. Advayan. So when we say that I am Brahman, and when we say that that tattvamasi, there is a trace of dualism. And that in Advaya, the trace of dualism is over, I think. So though Shankaracharya claims that union of a sort of union of and that union is not complete because there is a I and there is am. So aham brahmasmi, there is a Brahman aham. So that's why I may be wrong. I understand that his contribution, the contribution of Sri Vats Goswamiji to, in today's lecture is very important, that though he did not talk about loudly about the limitations of Advaitism, but he has contributed to our knowledge. And certainly there is a distinction between revelation and self-realization. Revelation, in revelation, especially in prophetic religion, it comes from God. But while self-realization, we make, it is not the grace of the God, but somewhat it is man's effort. So man, when man in bhakti also, there is a role of reason, especially if it is in mysticism, we transcend reason, but in bhakti we so naturally the cognitive, conative and aesthetic aspects cannot be separated, because man is composed of this knowing aspect, feeling aspects and doing aspect. So in Bhagavad Gita also we have got jnana yoga, bhakti yoga or karma yoga, and naturally we cannot separate jnana yoga, bhakti yoga or karma yoga. So it may be a matter of distribution of emphasis. Some of the T.R.B. Murthy emphasized on feeling aspect. K.C. Bhattacharya, as far as I understand, that he emphasized on the philosophical, he understood philosophy as theoretic consciousness. So naturally, K.C. Bhattacharya puts emphasis on the rational discourse. And I understand that the contribution of Manasri Goswamiji is a great one, because he has underscored the limitations of Advaitism, not very loudly. I can admit it, not very loudly, but while making a distinction, he has. That can be treated as a contribution, and I am thankful to Goswamiji. And I knew him since the days of when I was a researcher in BHU, and naturally T.R.B. Murthy was the head of the department, but I was in the sister department, that was in the Department of Indian Philosophy and Religion, working under Professor R.S. Mishra. And so I have received some guests, so I thank you all. I'm thankful to all the participants. With these words, I close this session.
There will be a formal vote of thanks from Dr. Manish Sinsirwar, who is a member of the Jai Krishna Academy Foundation, life member.
Thank you, ma'am.
Manish, please.
Thank you, ma'am. Good evening, all. On behalf of the Jai Krishna Academic Foundation, first of all, I would like to convey my regards and to express my sincere thanks to Honorable Acharya.
We would like to see your face, Manish.
Ma'am, my yes, ma'am.
He is visible.
Ma'am.
Oh, you are? I can't see it. Anyway.
Radhe, Radhe.
I am here, ma'am.
Radhe, Radhe.
He's visible, madam.
Thank you, sir. On behalf of the Jai Krishna Academic Foundation, first of all, I would like to convey my regards and to express my sincere thanks to Honorable Acharya Srivatsa Goswamiji for his erudite lecture, which made this Jai Krishna Memorial Lecture really an indelible discourse. I must mention our deep sense of appreciation for Professor R.C. Sinha, Chairman, Indian Council of Philosophical Research, for his valuable presidential remarks. Thank you very much, sir. I also wish to express our thanks to all the participants of the Jai Krishna essay competition for their interest and valuable contribution. Also, we would like to acknowledge our gratitude to Dr. Purunandan ji for all the technical support for this lecture, which is very important in this pandemic time. Finally, we are very grateful to all the respected participants for being with us this evening. Once again, thank you very much to all. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, everybody. Namaskar, Goswami ji. Namaskar, Sinha sahab. Bahut bahut dhanyawad aap sabko. Aur baki jo hum logon ke saath mein foundation se jud paaye.
Namaskar.
I can see where people.